Good morning, myself Dr. Shivaraman. Today, that is the third day of my talk on geodesy. I'll be talking about the old type of geodetic surveying. In my previous two lectures, you heard about the coordinate systems, ellipsoid, basic definitions used in surveying. And today, I will talk how before the advent of satellites, the survey was carried out, the coordinates were determined, and how the maps were produced. The dictionary defines a survey as to determine the and delineate form, extent, and position of a tract of land by taking linear and angular measurements and by applying the principles of geometry and trigonometry. Basically, in survey, you will see, as I discuss, linear measurements, lengths are done using chains, and angular measurements using theodolites. And the principles of geometry and trigonometry are used to determine the coordinates of all the points on the surface of the earth. There are basically four traditional surveying techniques which were used. One is an astronomical positioning, second one is a triangulation, third one is called trilateration, and fourth one is traverse. I will be covering all these four in my talk today. In recent years, modern technological developments have added several new methods utilizing artificial earth satellites that I will be covering in subsequent lectures. Another field of endeavor that is called photogrammetry has also been combined with geodetic survey for many years, and that is how the maps are prepared. There are two types of surveying, horizontal and vertical positioning. So I will be dealing with both of these. So the survey has been conducted independently. One is called horizontal positioning and another is vertical positioning. In horizontal positioning, basically latitude, longitude is determined, and in vertical positioning, the height above the geode is determined. So astronomic positioning is the oldest positioning method, and that has been used by Survey of India since 1780. The whole of India has been surveyed by Britishers starting from 1780, and it was completed after 100 years, that is 1880, and that is how the whole of India, the Survey of India maps which are produced, which are available now, are made. How the position of a point on the surface of the earth, that is the coordinates, latitude and longitude, can be obtained directly by observing the stars. That is the basic principle in the horizontal positioning. It has been used for many years by mariners by observing the pole stars they used to travel, and also by airmen for navigational purposes. Explorers like Columbus, Vasco da Gama have been using astronomical methods to locate themselves in the uncharted areas or in the seas. So they were basically using the geodesy for navigating, using the stars. Geodesists must use astronomic positioning along with other type of surveys such as triangulation and trilateral to establish precise positioning. Single astronomic observations not interconnected by geodetic survey cannot be related to each other with sufficient accuracy for the computation of distance and direction between points. So basically, in horizontal positioning, the positions are determined of different points using astronomy, and these points are interconnected by surveys and distances are computed. So now you will come the basic definitions of what is astronomical latitude and astronomical longitude. So in this diagram, you will see the physical surface. This is the actual physical surface. And this is a point P. And from point P, a normally drawn normally drawn to the physical surface, and that meets at this point. And this angle with respect to the xy axis is the astronomical latitude. And this is the meridian passing through the Greenwich, and with respect to that, the angle made by the normal with respect to that is the longitude. Astronomical latitude is defined as the angle between perpendicular to the geode, that is a normal, the vertical plumb line is actually perpendicular to the geode, not to the ellipsoid, and that line and the plane of the equator, that is angle between the perpendicular to the geode or the vertical plumb line and the plane of the equator, the xy plane, is defined as astronomical latitude. As the name implies, they are obtained by measuring angles between the plumb line at that point and a star or a series of stars and recording the precise time at which the measurements are made. So what is done is, the plumb line gives the vertical direction, and whenever a known star transits over the vertical, the time is exactly marked at what time the star passes over the vertical. Now, similar observations are taken at Greenwich. When the transit of that same star passes over Greenwich, they mark their time. So the time difference of a particular star transiting over the normal, that is a vertical over your head, at Greenwich and your local vertical, the time difference multiplied by 15 degree gives the astronomical latitude. That is, after combining the data with the information obtained from star catalogs, the direction of the is computed. While geodesists use elaborate and very precise technique for determining astronomical latitude, the simplest method in the northern hemisphere is to measure the elevation of polaris, that is the north pole, above the horizon of the observer. So you can measure also, because in northern hemisphere you can see the pole star, that is the pole star, a star, particular star, vertically above the axis of the earth. The angle of star, the polar star, with respect to your local vertical, if you can measure using a telescope, that angle also can be used to measure the latitude of that particular place. This is basically how the astronomical latitude is measured. Either you can use the pole star if you are a northern pole, or measure the transit time at your place as well as the Greenwich, and the time difference also can be used to determine the astronomical latitude. By reference to star catalogs, the exact Greenwich mean time that a star was over the prime meridian is obtained. That is, the time at which a particular longitude is Greenwich meridian is transit happens, the time is noted, and the time difference between the point and the Greenwich is used to compute the astronomical longitude of the point. Since the point on the earth rotates to 360 degrees in 24 hours, difference in local time between the points can be easily converted into difference in the longitude. Another astronomical observation related to horizontal positioning is called astronomical azimuth. That is, in addition to latitude and longitude, you need also to measure astronomical azimuth. This is actually when you are at a particular place, you have got a particular direction called east, south, west. The north points towards the axis of the earth. So you can measure angle between, suppose you have got two points A and B on the surface of the earth. The azimuth of the line A to B is the angle from A observed towards the north direction, and with respect to that, measure the angle towards that direction. So the angle of the line A to B with respect to the north at A is called azimuth. Very accurate azimuths are obtained use to controlling the orientation of first order triangulation, which I will come later. Astronomical observations are made with optical instruments. They are at theodolites, zenith camera, prismatic astrolabe, which all contain leveling devices, because these instruments has to be kept horizontal, and a leveling a spirit level is used to see that they are at level. When properly adjusted, the vertical axis of the instrument coincides with the direction of gravity and is therefore perpendicular to the geoid. So all these horizontal measurements are done with respect to the perpendicular geoid, that is the local vertical. The astronomical positions are referred to geoid, and since geoid is irregular, non-mathematical surface, astronomical positions are wholly independent of each other. So, after completing the definitions, now will come the first technique of survey, that is called triangulation. That is basically used in our country as early as 1780 to 1880. For 100 years, this was completed, and that is how the Survey of India maps have been produced. This is the most common type of geodetic survey world, and it differs from the plane survey mentioned earlier, that more accurate instruments are used, basically a theodolite and a chain, accurately calibrated chain is used to measure distances. Instrumental errors are either removed or predetermined so that they can be compensated for the computations, and more rigorous procedures are employed to reduce observation errors. Another important difference is that all of the positions established by triangulation are mathematically related to each other. This is a basic characteristic of triangulation. Here you will see a simple triangulation network. This is a point C, A, that is a starting point of the prepare the map over a country like India. For India, this starting point was a station called Kalyanpur near Bhopal. And from this, around 40 kilometers away, another station was chosen. These stations are all on a hill so that you can see the stations one another using theodolites. So this is another station around 40 to 50 kilometers away. So you have a line, this is the point A, this A to B. So this line, this distance A to B is very accurately computed using chains character for all errors. So using a chain, this is measured, and also azimuth of this line AB, that is that direction from north, how much is this angle, this line AB is also measured. So the name known basic data is the length of the baseline AB. And at A, astronomical latitude and longitude are measured as explained previously, and azimuth of the line AB is also done. So you have got the orientation of the line AB, latitude and longitude of this A, as well as B also of the line. Now from here, suppose you have got a new point. This is a C here. The latitude and longitude of this point C is obtained by measuring, building small network like this, A to B, you have got angular, measure the distance, measure the angles only, now only angles. These angles are measured between this, with respect to new station here, then from here, the angle is measured to this station, then from here, angle is measured to this station and this station. So all the stations, intermediately for at 40 kilometers, stations are, geodetic stations are set up, and the angles, all these angles are measured, and finally you come to this point C. And all these angular measurements can be used to measure the coordinates, you get the coordinates of point C, and length and azimuth of the line A to C, AC, and also length and azimuth of all other lines also in this geodetic network. And you also get the coordinates of all these points also, from basically by measuring the distance A to B and azimuth, and knowing the coordinates of A to A and B, which are determined by astronomical methods. Once these stations are coordinates are determined, all other coordinates are determined by only using angular measurements from A and B to all other stations. In fact, when a network is set, all this and come to the point C, we can go back also and compute the latitude and longitude of A and B. And you will see that when you recalculate A to B from backward, the values don't agree. There will be, because of the errors, the new values computed will be in error, and there is an adjustment made by distributing this error as per the lines, baseline distances of all this network of triangulation network. So basically in triangulation, azimuth of a line, latitude and longitude of a two stations are known, and measuring the angles between other control networks, the coordinates of all the points in this network is determined. This is called basically a triangulation method. So this map shows what are all the places where the triangulation has been done. You will see here many places in Africa, this China, they are all not covered, but most of the places have been covered by triangulation network. Over India, you can see a big trigonometrical survey of India, which has been done from 1780 to 1880. And you see here, starting from this Kalyanpur, networks are built up, and all these places, the coordinates are determined at distances of 40 to 50 kilometers. These stations are called geodetic control points. And with respect to this, are there any places on the earth, on India, can be done, surveyed, and their coordinates can be determined. But the primary network of the geodetic network is all these points up to the southern end of India. So in India, maps by Survey of India were prepared with a reference to triangulation network points based on geodetic triangulation of India computed on an Everest spheroid. All these computations, you need a spheroid also, and that is basically Everest spheroid whose semi-major axis and semi-flattening are these values. It was first adjusted, that is the network, when you do the measurement, they are adjusted for any errors, residual errors, by recalculating known points, and it has, starting from 1780, when the measurements were completed after 100 years, the network was adjusted so that the errors are distributed and better accuracy is obtained. So by 1880, the complete triangulation network has been completed in India. The Indian datum has been used for India and several adjacent countries of South Central Asia like Pakistan, Burma, Bangladesh, etc. So all these countries also, because they were all under British control, has been covered in this 100 years of survey. It is computed on Everest spheroid with its origin at Kalyanpur in Central India. Kalyanpur is a station where basically the astronomical observations taken to determine latitude and longitude, and by measuring the angles with respect to other network, other coordinates are determined. It has been assumed, that is basically there is an assumption, that is one of the things which can cause error, that is the geoid and ellipsoid at Kalyanpur is coinciding. There is no difference between ellipsoid and geoid, which is not correct. So the latitude of Kalyanpur is 24 degree 7 minutes 11.26 seconds north, and longitude is 77 degree 39 minutes 17.57 degree east of Greenwich. So this is basically the coordinates obtained of Kalyanpur using the astronomical observations, and further coordinates have been computed. And basic assumption is that the geoid and ellipsoid coincide, and there is no difference between that. So in addition to the errors due to measurements, there is an error to geoid and ellipsoid coinciding as taken as an assumption at Kalyanpur. So this is another diagram showing this is normal drawn to the ellipsoid. This is the ellipsoid, this is the axis of the ellipsoid, and this is the astronomical latitude. And if the, because at Kalyanpur, the geoid ellipsoid are assumed same, so the normal to the ellipsoid and normal to the geoid are the same. So the astronomical latitude which was measured, assuming that plumb line, with respect to plumb line, the star position is noted, is the same as the geodetic latitude at that point. Actually, these two lines are do not coincide. The normal to the ellipsoid and normal to geoid at Kalyanpur are different, but it is assumed that both are coinciding. And because of that, the astronomical latitude is taken as equal to the geodetic latitude at Kalyanpur. And that was the starting point for the all the surveys. So there are different orders of triangulation network depending on the accuracy that is achieved. The first order, primary control, horizontal control, is the most accurate triangulation. That is, the accuracy of the coordinates obtained in the first order network is very accurate. It is a costly means of surveying, and it is also time consuming because repeated observations are used using the best instruments and rigorous computation methods like adjusting the network. First order triangulation is usually used to provide basic framework or horizontal control for a large area such as for national network. So this is basically used for building up a national network. It has been also used in preparation for metropolitan expansion, scientific studies requiring exact geodetic data, and its accuracy is at least one part in 1 lakh. That is, there will be an error of 1 meter if you go every 100 kilometer, there can be an error of 1 meter on that, that can be tolerated in this basic measurement. Then comes the second order network, that is, first build the basic first order network. From that, whatever is survey is done, taking that set correct, you do the second order survey, and that is called second order class 1 secondary horizontal control. That includes the area networks between the first order arcs and detailed surveys in a very high value and other areas. Surveys of this class strengthen the great triangulation network of India, established by Survey of India, and are adjusted as part of the network. Again, adjustment is made. Therefore, this class also includes basic framework for further classification. The Indian equations of second order class 1 triangulation should indicate an accuracy of at least one part in 50,000. That is, the accuracy is every 50 kilometer there can be an error tolerated up to 1 meter. The set order triangulation demands for reliable horizontal network surveys, horizontal control surveys in areas which are not high state of development and where no such development is anticipated in the near future, and justify the need for a triangulation classifier second order class 2, that is a supplementary horizontal control. This class is used to establish control along strain, inland waterways, interstate highways. The control data contributes to the national network and is published as part of the network. The minimum accuracy here is one part in 20,000, that is 1 meter every kilometers. Then there is a third order triangulation network. The accuracy is 1 in 10,000. That is, there is a first order which is the starting point. From there, the second order is network is established and coordinates are determined, and from them, a third order network of classification is done, and that is how the whole of country has been covered for preparing maps. There is a second method that is called trilateralization network. Here again, we have got 2 points A and B. Astronomical coordinates are obtained and length of the baseline is obtained. But instead of measuring the angles, the sides are measured. Sides of this triangle is measured A, B, and say suppose this is point. This all these baselines are measured accurately using chains, and point C the coordinates is determined. So basically, no angle measurement is done in trilateralization. It is basically the length measurement that is used. Since very long baselines, say up to 500 miles, could be measured by these systems, geodetic triangulation networks have been extended over vast areas in comparatively short period of time, that is by measuring the angles. Surveys of islands and even continents separated by extensive barriers have been connected by trilateralization. That is, how the islands are connected to the mainland. The examples are Canadian shoreline network connecting the sparsely populated northern coastal central island areas, central part of the country, North Atlantic shoreline network, and North America, then some parts of Europe, and only distances measured in trilateration, and each side is measured separate repeatedly to ensure precision. Entire network is then adjusted in terms of length, and then the angle, the coordinates are determined. Then angles are also computed so that geodetic positions are obtained as calculation. Once you measure the distances of a particular triangle, the angles can be measured, computed, and then the coordinates can be determined. So these are all the areas. Basically, Canada has been covered by trilateration. There is a small part here, trilateration, but it is very rarely used, and most popular one is triangulation. Then there is another that is called traverse, where starting from A to B, you measure the line from A to a control point here. You measure a line from this point to this point. You measure a length of the line from this point to this point, then this point to this point, then this point to this point. Measuring lines, but not crossing them like a triangle, you determine the coordinates of point C. That is the traverse. And this is called an open traverse because you are not crossing it anywhere. You can have a closed traverse. You can start from a point A, measure the distance like this, then this distance, then this distance. You go on measuring the distances and then come back and close it and then determine the point. And that is called a closed traverse. The simplest method of extending control is called traverse. And this is similar to data reckoning navigation, where distances and directions are measured in the case of navigation. The surveyor starts at a known position with a known azimuth to another point and measures angles and distances with a series of survey points. So this is basically the traverse. Electronic distance measuring equipment has become available. The traverse is very popular, and it is used to determine, to make small surveys, that is close surveys. And because of the EDM instruments, the accuracy of traverse survey has increased significantly. So nowadays, instead of chains, you would have seen on the road using electronic distance measurement equipment with a tripod and a transmitter. That is what is done in the traverse. There's another instrument called telerometer, that is a microwave instrument. It is used in Australia to complete a network that is determine the Australian geodetic data covering that country. That is, in Australia, traverse is used using a telerometer, and that is how the survey is done there. The average loop length of distance is around 900 miles, and average closed loop is of this work is 2.2 parts per million. That is the accuracy of this. The laser geodimeter, that is another instrument, used to produce internal application better than one part in 1 million, and that has been used in United States. The traverse consists of a series of high precision length, also length, angle, and astronomical azimuth measurements ranging approximately east-west and north-south through the conterminous states, forming somewhat rectangular loops. This traverse is the backbone of a readjustment of the horizontal network, control network in the US. So the US, originally the triangulation was done, but it was, the survey has been redone using the traverse technique, and that is the backbone of the maps prepared by US. This has not been done in India. So this is a transcontinental network of traverse, long distances, and measuring the length and of this, the whole of US has been surveyed. Now this basically, whatever I measured, the horizontal survey gives only latitude and longitude of all the points, all the reference points, and all these points, most of them are on the top of a hill. And once these coordinates are determined, usually the survey people dig the earth and up to about 1 or 2 meters, put a concrete platform put a brass on that, mark it, and write, and then close it, and on the top of that also another platform is built up and mark it. So these are the control points, and they are existing many places in India, and with respect to that, other surveys are done. Now, the heights are measured with respect to geode, that is the mean, and that is called basically the vertical positioning. It is a process of determining heights, elevations above the mean sea level surface. That is, heights are measured with respect to the mean sea level. As noted earlier, the geode corresponds to mean sea level in the open sea. In geodetic surveys executed primarily for mapping purposes, there is no problem in the fact that geodetic positions are referred to an ellipsoid and elevations of the positions are referred to. Even though the reference are different for horizontal positioning is ellipsoid and height is a geode, there is no problem in using the maps. So the Survey of India map, whatever you see, the height is with respect to the geode, that is the mean sea level. Like in railway stations, you will see the height of the station, railway station, is so many meters above the mean sea level. But it is not with respect to the ellipsoid. It is with respect to mean sea level. But there is no problem that horizontal and vertical using different surfaces. But nowadays, with the advent of satellites, it is the ellipsoid that is used for high latitude, longitude, and height. And when I cover satellite geodesy, you will come to see the advantages of that and of that. But basically, the Survey of India maps prepared in two different ways and two reference surfaces have no problem in using for our practical purposes. Our geodetic data for missiles require an adjustment in the elevation information to compensate for the undulations of the geode above and below the regular mathematical surface of the ellipsoid. Basically, for survey, that different surfaces use doesn't matter. But suppose you are launching a missile, it is very essential to see, because basically when you launch a missile, it is the gravity of the earth and the geode, geode is actually equipotential surface, where the potential geopotentials are constant. So the missile travels under the influence of this gravity. So it requires an adjustment to the elevation information to compensate for the undulations of the geode. So the adjustment uses complex advanced geodetic techniques are used for use for missile launching. But for basic survey, the geode height is good enough. Precise geodetic leveling is used to establish a basic network of vertical control points. For this, from this, height of other positions in the survey can be determined by supplementary methods. So basically, a network is established, primary network, where the heights are determined with respect to mean sea level, and then the supplementary methods are used to determine the heights of other places. The mean sea level surface is used as a reference, that is called vertical datum, and it is determined by obtaining an average hourly water heights for a period of several years at tidal heights at ocean, at the sea land boundaries. And with that, when you are at sea, the mean sea level is determined and height of that place is determined with respect to that. And then the survey is done towards the land. There are three leveling techniques: differential, hygrometric, and barometric, which I will explain now. With the instrument locked in position, readings are made two calibrated stops held in upright position and behind the instrument. The difference between readings is the difference in the elevation between the two points. So this is the thing. Suppose you get a mean sea level surface, this is the sea, and you get at the seashore a point A where you determine the mean sea level height. That is the height of with respect to the ellipsoid. That is, the ellipsoid and geode will not coincide. You get a height of the mean sea level above or below the ellipsoid at this point by taking tidal observations. So you will see a lot of tidal stations which are meant for this. From this, you look into the land and you have got a point B, and measure the angle from A to B, which is at higher height. This angle higher, that angle is measured, and the height, this height of the B is determined with respect to A as the height above the mean sea level. Now from this again, you go to a point, another point, measure the height with respect to this. So here what is done is, you have got a vertical plane here, and you have got a theodolite, that is, that can measure the mark, and this is the another pole here. You keep the pole, this pole at point A, and this pole at point B or D. With this, you observe what is the height of this pole here, and what is the height of the pole here. Because this is at a higher, this pole will be higher, and the difference in the height between these two poles can be measured easily. Since you know that this coincides with the mean sea level, this height is zero, and the height difference gives the height of this point, say D, above the mean sea level. And thus you go on building internally and measure the height above the mean sea level. When the height decreases also, you can measure the height, and that is how the mean sea level of all the internal sections are determined once you know the mean sea level surface at the seashore. So the known data is elevation of the starting point A, that is with respect to sea level, and elevation difference between A, B, C, D, etc., and all other points, and you get elevation, that is the height difference of all the stations, and that gives the geodetic the height of the other stations. It involves measuring of vertical angle from a known distance with a theodolite and computing the elevation of that point. With this measurement, with this method, vertical measurements can be made. At the same time, horizontals are also measured for triangulation. So triangulation and this leveling are done simultaneously so that you get the coordinates as well as the height. It is therefore a somewhat more economical method, but less accurate than differential leveling. That is called triangulation leveling, second one. It is often the only practical method of establishing accurate elevation control in mountainous areas. So that is called trigonometric leveling. So this is the thing. You measure the height of this point B, and also the coordinates, and go on measuring. Then there is a third method that is called barometric leveling. Here the differences in height are determined by measuring the difference in atmospheric pressure at various elevations. You may know that the pressure, atmospheric pressure, is a function of the height. At sea level it is around 760 millimeter. That is the actual value. Higher and higher, the pressure is different. The air pressure is measured by mercurial or aneroid barometers or a boiling point thermometer. Although the degree of accuracy, so by measuring the pressure, there is an equation that relates the pressure to the height, and that can be used. The degree of accuracy possible with this method is not great as by using the other two methods. But it obtains relative heights very rapidly at points which are fairly apart. If you want a rapid survey, this barometric leveling is very useful. It is widely used in the reconnaissance and exploratory surveys, where more exact measurements will be made later and are not required. And that is the third type of leveling that is used. So this is a barometric leveling. The barometer which measures the pressure. The elevation of the starting point A is known, that is zero, that is mean sea level. And air pressure, and also material data is also collected, pressure at that point. Then the air pressure at A, B, and C are measured. And then they can, from the pressure difference, you can compute the elevation, that is height of B, C, and other points. Because there is a relation between pressure and height. Pressure variation with height. Now there are basically two terms in survey which are used, and you should know the difference between these two. One is called precision and another is called accuracy. A distinction between precision and accuracy is very necessary. A general rule of thumb is that precision refers to repeatability, while accuracy refers to closeness of the truth. That is, whatever you measure and compute at other points, it is not the true value. But what is the advantage of this? That these values are repeated. You can get a repeated measurements close to that by again doing a measurement. So how close is the repeated measurement to the actual truth is the precision, and how close is the real value what you obtain is the accuracy of that. For example, if I measure the distance between two geodetic stations 25 times and spread of a measurement is only 5 millimeter, they are very close of the order of 5 millimeter, I can conclude that my measurements are very precise. That is, they are repeatable within an accuracy of 5 millimeter. But if the mean of these measurements is say 25.00055 kilometers, where the true distance is 25 kilometer, the measurements which is precise, but they are not accurate. I am not getting accurate value of 25 kilometer. There is an error. But every time I do the repeated measurements, I will be getting the repeated, which is so accurate as this much accuracy. So this is the basic difference between precision and accuracy. So every time, whether we use the old survey methods or a GPS technique, it is repeatable. How repeatable we can get the coordinates, what is the accuracy of that, is the accuracy of that system. For example, GPS, when they say that using a code, you can get 100 meter accuracy. That is, when you have repeated observation with a GPS at a particular place, every day, different days, all these points you measure with the GPS will all lie within a circle of 100 meters 99% of the time. So this is the difference between precision and accuracy. The figure one, these are three diagrams where a gunshot is shot to a target, and a shooter shoots, and all these shots are at this point. This is the center of the target, but he has shot all these at these points. Here the target shooter has been fairly precise. That is, all his shooting has been very close, repeatably hitting roughly the same spot. So any technique will be able to get this repeatability like this. But assuming the shooter was aiming for bullseye, they have not been very accurate. In fact, he is not correctly hit here, but all his head has been off, but he is accurate, but not precise. It is not accurate, but is precise to this point. In figure 2, you will see the shooter has shot around this center, that is the target, and is less precise. That is not very close to that, but has been more accurate. That is closer to the bullseye. Is closer to the bullseye than in figure 1. That is, if you take a mean of this, it will be closer to the real truth of this point. But if the shooter has been close enough and shot at the target like this, it is also precise as well as accurate. But basically, the GPS of any techniques, it is not precise, but the accuracy when they talk is the repeat accuracy. Now, when you do the survey from a point, basically the networks are adjusted. So after all the network is done and all measurements have been done, it is tested for the closeness and recalculation is done, and whatever error is there is distributed. Usually the geodetic network measurements are adjusted using what is called technique. So the network is adjusted by determining the errors and distributing. This is because it is easy to apply, since normal equations are linear. It gives a unique solution, provides a covariance matrix of parameters that gives basically the accuracy of the measurements. It can be applied to wide variety of problems, and least square estimate is unbiased. So basically in geodetic adjustment, geodetic network measurements, a least square technique is used to adjust so that the errors are minimized. I think with this, I will end my lecture and thank you very much.